plagued by corruption and desperate to beat the Americans at every turn, the Soviet space program risked the lives of their cosmonauts at an astonishing rate. Until 1967, every death in space was that of a Russian cosmonaut. Join us as we revisit the worst space disasters in Soviet history. By the 1960s, the Soviet Union had pulled ahead in the space race against the United States. Designed to replace the aging Voskhod, which had propelled cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin to low Earth orbit, the Soyuz was to be the answer to the American Apollo program in the quest to reach the moon. But by 1967, the Soviet leadership became impatient with the delays to the program. The United States was catching up in the race, and Leonid Brezhnev, the General Secretary of the USSR, wanted to awe the world with another Soviet achievement. In April 1967, Soyuz 1 was launched and was propelled at over 8,000 miles per hour into space. On board was 37-year-old cosmonaut Vladimir Komarov. An experienced test pilot, Komarov's mission was to guide the spacecraft into low Earth orbit and wait for the launch of a second craft, Soyuz 2, from the Baikonur Cosmodrome. Once both vessels were in their correct orbits, they would attempt an EVA in outer space, the first of its kind in human history. The two crewmen of Soyuz 2 were to guide their craft towards Soyuz 1 and perform the dangerous and highly technical maneuver. The three cosmonauts would then decouple from Soyuz 2 and attempt a re-entry in Soyuz 1. But as Soyuz 1 stabilized its orbit around Earth, the launch of Soyuz 2 was cancelled due to technical failures. This left Komarov in a dangerous position as he orbited the planet. He would have to abort his mission and attempt to bring the Soyuz 1 back to Earth safely by himself. But before he could even begin his descent, disaster struck. The automatic navigation system guiding the craft failed. Hurtling around the Earth at thousands of miles per hour, Komarov had to manually steer the craft without any navigational aid. In a testament to his skills as a pilot, Komarov managed to stabilize the craft's trajectory and begin to bring the Soyuz 1 back to Earth. But as Komarov descended into the Earth's atmosphere, the worst happened. The main parachute that was meant to slow his descent failed to open. Plunging toward the Earth, the craft was completely unresponsive. There was nothing Komarov could do. Crashing into the ground at 130 feet per second, Komarov was killed instantly. One of the officials in charge of the rescue mission at the crash site later stated, "We discovered Komarov's body 1 hour after we started to clear the debris. At first, it was hard to distinguish what were his head, arms, and legs." Soviet officials attempted to suppress many of the details of the disaster from the public, including Komarov's final moments. Attempting to downplay the true events, it was claimed that Komarov became unconscious as his craft sped towards the Earth. But in reality, the cosmonaut was very much awake. As he plunged towards his death, Komarov was heard over the radio, crying in rage. He cursed the people who had put him inside the flawed spaceship. He told Mission Control that he knew he was about to die and that the men on the ground had killed him. Komarov's wife was also on the call and asked what to say to their children. His last words were, "Heat is rising in the capsule." To prepare cosmonauts for their journey into space, it was policy for each candidate to undergo physiological and psychological testing by Soviet scientists. Valentin Bondarenko was one such candidate, selected in 1960 as part of the first batch of 20 Soviet cosmonauts who would train on the Vostok spacecraft. He had already proven himself as a competent test pilot in the Soviet Air Force. The youngest of the hand-picked pilots, Bondarenko was known for his mild-mannered nature and was well-liked by many in the program. In March 1961, in a research facility in Moscow, Bondarenko was placed in a pressurized chamber for evaluation. His psychological and physical state would be monitored, all while he was under strict isolation for 15 days. On the 10th day, Bondarenko finished a round of physical tests, which involved having biomonitors attached to his body. That day, the room was pressurized below regular atmospheric pressure and was filled with a higher proportion of oxygen. While removing biomonitors attached to his body, Bondarenko poured alcohol onto a ball of cotton and rubbed off the glue that was used to fix them to his skin. He tossed the alcohol-soaked ball across the room. It landed on the open flame of a nearby stove and caught fire. As the fire grew in size, Bondarenko attempted to extinguish the flames, but instead, the fire grew larger. In the oxygen-rich environment, the fire began to engulf the small room. The flames then spread to Bondarenko, and his wool jumpsuit that was meant to be fire retardant burst into flames. Hearing screams over the intercom, the doctors who were monitoring the chamber realized that something was wrong, and raced to the door of the chamber, attempting to open it. but the lower pressure inside the chamber created a vacuum, and the scientists were unable to open the sealed door no matter how hard they tried. Realizing this, the order was given to decrease the vacuum in the chamber to equalize the pressure, but this only helped to further fan the flames, creating an inferno. The experiment had no safety procedures in place, and the men monitoring the experiment were ill-equipped to deal with any kind of fire, having no fire extinguishers readily at hand. By the time the doctors were able to open the door, Bondarenko was lying on the floor, covered in flames. Extinguishing the fire, the doctors could see that Bondarenko was burned beyond recognition. The man was heard moaning the words, "It was my fault. Don't blame anyone." The doctor on duty, Vladimir Golikovsky, would describe the scene. "I couldn't contain my trembling. The whole man was burned. His body was completely devoid of skin, his head of hair, and there were no eyes visible on his face. It was a solid burn of the highest degree, but the patient was still alive." Taken to a nearby hospital, doctors attempted to stabilize the man. Administering an intravenous drip, the only blood vessels that could be found for inserting a needle were on the sole of Bondarenko's feet, the only part of his body that wasn't burned. In his final moments, Golikovsky heard the test pilot say in a hoarse voice, "Please, do something to take the pain away." Bondarenko lay in suffering for 16 long hours until he finally passed away. The gross negligence of the Soviet scientists, with no procedures in place in case of an emergency, directly led to the cosmonaut's death. To hide the failures of the Soviet space program, Bondarenko was erased from public records, and it wasn't until 1986 when the story of his horrific death came to light. In 1969, the Soviet Union was beaten in the race to the moon by American astronauts Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin. Refusing to concede the race, the USSR focused their efforts on launching the first space station in 1971, called the Salyut 1. Georgi Dobrovolski, Vladislav Volkov, and Viktor Patsayev were to be the first men to enter the new station via the spaceship Soyuz 11. Launching on board Soyuz 11 on June 6, 1971, the cosmonauts were to spend 3 weeks orbiting the Earth. The intense pressure from the Soviet High Command led to the testing phase of both the Salyut space station and the Soyuz spacecraft being rushed. Both craft were launched with known design flaws. On June 7, the crew successfully docked with the space station and began a 3-week mission of scientific experiments and observations of Earth from orbit. On June 11, a fire broke out in the space station and the crew barely managed to keep the fire from spreading in the high oxygen environment. Mission Control debated whether to scrub the mission, but decided to proceed. The stakes were now too high for a second cancelled mission. Just 2 months earlier, the spacecraft Soyuz 10 had failed to dock with the Salyut space station due to a design flaw in the docking mechanism. On June 29th, in preparation for final departure, the three cosmonauts loaded scientific specimens and other equipment into Soyuz 11, then transferred manual control back from Salyut 1 to their craft and began the undocking maneuver. The craft aligned itself for a re-entry flight path and began its descent. Radio contact was lost unexpectedly soon after. Mission Control continued to track the descent of Soyuz 1 via radar. Glowed by parachutes, it touched down in northern Kazakhstan. A recovery team made its way to the small town of Karajai, where their craft had landed, and began the process of extracting the men from the capsule. Tapping on the exit hatch, the team waited for the crew to open the door and disembark, but there was no response. Prying open the doors of the Soyuz 11, the team made a gruesome discovery. Two of the men were strapped to their chairs, completely motionless. Their faces were a dark shade of blue, and blood streamed from their ears and noses. The recovery team attempted CPR to revive the men, but it was too late for the cosmonauts. All three were dead. Dobrovolski was still warm. It was later determined that there was a problem with the breathing ventilation valve. Two bolts that were meant to fire sequentially fired simultaneously, creating a force that loosened a seal needed to adjust the pressure in the cabin. Rapidly losing pressure, the men had only 20 seconds to try to locate the ventilation valve and close it before the effects of oxygen starvation made it impossible for them to function. The valves were located beneath the seats. With only seconds to live, the men desperately searched. Lack of oxygen slowed their reflexes and blurred their vision. Patsayev's body was found positioned near the valve. Data from one of the men's biomedical sensors showed that he went into cardiac arrest within 40 seconds of pressure lost, dying of asphyxiation shortly after. The Soviet state media attempted to downplay the tragic events of the mission and instead emphasized its accomplishments during the crew's stay aboard Salyut 1. Details of the cause of death were not revealed until 2 years later. the Soviet space program proved to the world that the USSR was capable of being a spacefaring nation, but those achievements were earned by the blood of cosmonauts who were placed into poorly designed craft and on dangerously rushed missions so that men in the Kremlin could be lauded as heroes. In an act of unity, in 1971, a plaque was laid on the moon by the American crew of Apollo 15, dedicated to those who had died in the space race. The names of Komarov, Dobrovolski, Patsayev, and Volkov are now permanently etched on the moon. Thanks for watching, guys. If you enjoyed this video, please leave a like and a comment, and I'll see you next time.